And welcome. Bayern Munich continue to sing Sarpreet's praises as a Kiwi scores again. Another All Whites bags a goal, just in the wrong net. With more on the weekend's Premier League and the end of the silly transfer season, I'm joined by Victor Valdez-Waters, Simon Plum and Jack Mabeer, otherwise known as Blues Clues. Thanks for joining us this morning. Start off with the North London derby, shall we? 2-2. That was a rip-roaring game. Lots of action.
It was. You'd probably say it was the game of the weekend and not one you'd want young players to learn from, but for sheer entertainment
Maybe
value.
Basketball players.
Yeah, true. Yeah, it was a great watch and what a game. Yeah, 2-2.
Arsenal, are they going to be the team this season that the neutrals are just going to love watching?
They are exciting going forward, aren't they? But at the back, they're still a little bit shaky.
That's generous.
Yeah.
I was going to say.
I'm thinking the tactics that they use sometimes are quite negative, really. Because, like, in this game, for example, he had no real creative midfielder in there to supply his front three. So we got those front three exciting, you know, attacking players, but no one was really able to feed them any good balls, get the balls to them or anything like that. So I just wonder about the tactics there sometimes, whether he's a little bit too conservative while also trying to please the fans at the same time.
Well, that gives Victor an ideal opportunity to be able to say the name of our Spanish friend who came on.
Ceballos, who was on the bench. And, of course, when he came on, the game turned around a little bit. To come back from 2-0 at home, you know, that shows some grit and determination, but they shouldn't be 2-0 down at home to a Spurs side that haven't had the best start to the season.
To be fair, Lacazette's goal...
It was very good.
He absolutely rifled that goal in. Yeah. First touch, second touch, took it away from Vertonghen. Lloris just was totally beaten by the pace. But as you said, your mate, Ceballos, you'd think he's probably going to be starting soon, isn't he? He's obviously got this one season on loan from Real Madrid to upskill and then head back, but surely he's going to take the place of Granit Xhaka, who is probably still flying in on Heung-min Son. It was that late in the box.
Yeah, that was a terrible challenge. Absolutely woeful. Probably should have seen red for that. But you're right about Ceballos. I think a lot of the attention with Arsenal has been on Pepe. He's been good, but he's not really done too much so far. But Ceballos, he's got to be an absolute lock, surely.
And the pace that they've got now, does it remind you a little bit of Liverpool's front three in terms of being able to have Lacazette's almost the Firmino role, and then the other two just give you that pace and the unpredictability?
Yeah, very similar system, definitely, but the personnel might not be quite at the same standard. It's a bit like watching Liverpool a few years ago when they were really exciting going forward, but an absolute liability at the back, you know, before they got, obviously, the reinforcements in there. So, yeah, I think fans will be excited to see Arsenal attacking, but we'll probably have their, you know, the head in their hands whenever they...
Are you saying David Luiz is not the solution to their defensive woes?
I said that. Of course, they've also gotten rid of Monreal, who was one of their best defenders over the years. He's gone to Real Sociedad. So,
to where?
Real Sociedad. In the Basque Country.
Just before we move on from the North London derby, though, as a Tottenham fan, your thoughts on Harry Kane's alleged dive?
Well, he's had a couple the last couple of games, and he sort of said if it's in the middle of the park, it's probably a free kick. When it's in the box, it's not. But that's what VAR's there for. So if it is a dive, then VAR picks it up anyway. Yeah. And I think it's sort of no harm done, really, I think.
I don't know if diving is given in the halfway line, generally, is it?
No. What I can say about Harry Kane, though, is he scored 10 goals in 10 North London derbies. He loves playing against Arsenal.
Yeah, he does.
And that's an outstanding record. Top joint goal scorer for North London derbies, I believe.
Yeah, I feel like as an England fan, he is kind of getting that bit of a reputation, though, for looking for it a little bit. He was quite crafty, I thought. He kind of just moved into the defender and then fell over. But I think he does need to be careful.
In fact, the one against Newcastle, I thought, against Lascelles, probably was a penalty. This one, it looked clumsy, and it was almost because he sort of tumbled down and made such a big deal of it. You kind of think, well, that's not going to be given. But he does need to be careful with those sorts of issues. One England striker who is also banging them in, Tammy Abraham. Chelsea, look what happened when you can give the kids a go.
Yeah, that's right. 3 goals this season. And then, of course, the other player that scored for Chelsea this season is Mason Mount. So 2 English players. But the thing is, they've only got 2 goal scorers in, you know, the start of the season. They're not really getting goals from anywhere else on the pitch. But, you know, they still don't look like they're firing on all cylinders just yet.
Well, it was
yet,
2 all against Sheffield United, which is not an ideal situation, is it?
No, and not really. You know, and I think, again, they're another team which maybe has a sort of a, you know, defensive flaws, you know, which need straightening out. But I think what Lampard's done quite well with Abraham is said, right, here's the number 9 shirt, the legendary number 9 shirt, and you're my man this season. Go out and prove what you can do. And
so the power of the shirt, is that what
you're
going
on? But it's just a sort of a symbol, isn't it, for the manager to say, look, you're my number one striker. I'm relying on you this season. Go and show me what you can do. And he's done it in previous seasons in, you know, lower leagues. And, yeah, he's showing his power and accuracy now as well.
Was Alvaro Morata wearing number 9 before?
I think he was at Chelsea and then he changed it to 29 because that was the day his twins were born.
So like a homage. I thought he was trying to change the feng shui or something because he had a bit of a gnarly time, didn't he?
And so did Torres, remember?
He had a torrid time, didn't he?
Exactly.
Chris Wood, chalked off as an own goal for the All Whites.
Is
big
this
man.
Possibly one of the most ridiculous own goals ever seen in the Premier League. Club, I know you got strong thoughts on this.
Well, I just think it's stupid, to be honest. I mean, it's
harsh to be given against him as well.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of inconsequential, really, at the end of the day. Didn't do anything for Chris Wood and doesn't do anything for the actual outcome of the match. But
well, it did something for Liverpool, didn't it? 3-0, got them off and running.
Yeah, it's great that he was able to get his back exactly where it was, you know, for the to deflect that cross. But I thought it was a bit unreasonable, and I thought actually it was funny after the game they were talking to Jurgen Klopp about it, and they said, you know, that's been chalked off as an own goal. He couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
He looked down the barrel of the camera and said, "How can this be? How can this possibly, you know, take this goal away from Trent Alexander-Arnold?"
I'll tell you what, he needs to be having a chat to Harry Kane about how to claim goals back if he wants to have that sort of situation. Sarpreet Singh, another goal for the Bayern Munich Rezzies, and what a classy goal at that.
Absolutely. What we call it, sort of a volley chip. He just sort of gets there, right place, right time, just lobs it over neatly over the goalkeeper. It was a really well-taken goal.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't particularly well worked, just a massive punt from the back.
Well, but I was going to say, this is as a beautiful. Forget the pressing and the short game and players trying to play out from the
Wimbledon.
Keeper.
Wimbledon. Old school Wimbledon.
The finish to do that was sensational.
It was a lovely touch, got to be said. Real composure there, and just the class of the finish was really nice to see. Good on him.
And it's quite nice that even though he is playing in the second team, he's still actually getting that exposure because the second teams over in Europe are still a big deal as well. It's not like necessarily in the Premier League when the reserves don't really get much exposure.
Yeah, that's true, actually. I think the European teams do. Maybe that's a reflection of depth or just how deep the Premier League is and how much interest there is just on the first team. But he's still making a name for himself over there, even though he's in the reserves, like you're saying. If he can keep doing that, then he may even make the bench or the 18 for the first team.
And I wonder if he'll even get a sniff in for the Champions League squads when they have to be finalised, because they've got Tottenham in their group, which I'm very much looking forward to seeing that match up. Let's take a break now, and then when we come back, we'll have a look at some European football. Gareth Bale, remember him? Well, he's scoring goals again. Well, Gareth Bale, he was going to be booted out of Real Madrid against his will, but somehow he dug in. He said, "No, I'm not leaving my 5 kajillion euro a week contract. I'm going to stay here and I'm going to score goals." And he did just that against Villarreal.
Yeah, 2 goals, and then he got sent off. And, of course, it's quite funny because in July, Zidane came out saying, "Look, I want Gareth Bale gone, and if he can be gone tomorrow, even better." And, you know, he's come back, he scored 2 goals.
The French, eh? They've just got a way.
Je ne sais quoi.
Exactly.
But he scored last week as well. He's scoring for them. He's getting the goals that, you know, they probably needed last season. They're still not doing very well. They're doing better than Barcelona, but we'll get to that in a bit. But, you know, he's certainly proving the manager wrong.
I sort of love, it's almost Zidane-esque though, score a couple of goals, get sent off. It's a big boss move, isn't it?
Maybe he had a tea time to make and he just wanted to get the film.
Or get back to his golf course.
But I feel like this is, we've kind of been here before with Beckham and Capello.
Yeah.
Beckham was really on the periphery at Real. Capello wanted him out, but Beckham came back, did the goods and actually outsaw the manager. You could potentially see another situation with Bale like
that. But that's what happened the first time round, wasn't it? Because he was there and then they won the European Cup. He scored the amazing goal against Liverpool in the final. And then Zidane left, so he had a lifeline, didn't take it, and Zidane came back.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, the way it goes with Real Madrid managers, you know, you just wait around long enough and there'll be another one along in a minute kind of thing, you know? So, I think he's you know, he was desperate to get out there, wasn't he? I think they actually blocked his move to China in the end, didn't they? They said he couldn't go. So he's sort of being held there against his will, if you like, but
he's a prisoner. He's a prisoner
being
around
paid
Madrid.
Huge amounts of money.
I'll tell you who else is a prisoner.
Yes,
Neymar
in the golden prison, as they call it. Yeah.
The golden prison. In fact, he's on our table at the moment, and obviously assuming the customary position of rolling over on the floor because he's diving. There he is. I'll just turn him for you so you can get the hairstyle in there. Have a look at that. Oh, he is currently being holed up in a Parisian cell known as Paris Saint-Germain. trying to get himself to Barcelona.
And apparently, by all accounts, yesterday he was in the fetal position as well. Very upset that his move to Barcelona was basically unable to come to fruition. Mm. He was desperate to leave PSG. And PSG just, they still think he's worth 300 million euros.
I love it. I love seeing these big babies forced against their will to honour a contract. There's nothing better than it. And let's not forget that he's actually currently in legal proceedings against Barcelona, correct, who he's, what, suing for other wages and bits and pieces?
Well, it's to do with he got a bonus. He was meant to get a bonus for signing his contract before he left his renewal. And, of course, they didn't give it to him because he left straight after signing that renewal to PSG. So there's sort of these contractual issues going on between him and the club. Whether they would have been sorted out if he did come to Barcelona, who knows? But
does that not show the problems that your club is in at the moment?
Well, also, the club spent so much money on Griezmann, they were going to have to get another loan out to sign Neymar. They couldn't financially sign him. They literally had to get rid of players before they could sign him. That's why Rakitic, Dembele and Tadebo were all involved in this transfer, plus 100 million euros.
Who wants him? Who wants Neymar?
No one.
I would not touch him with a barge pole.
I'd take him for Forest, but I don't think anyone else would.
I think it's strictly Portuguese, is that Forest side.
We're the new Wolves.
Barcelona do have a sort of a younger option,
Yes. Ansu Fati, remember the name. 16-year-old, scored in his second game for Barcelona. 2-2 draw at Osasuna, not a great result. They still haven't really been firing on all cylinders either. Griezmann was invisible in that game. And a 16-year-old, Sean, when there's no Messi, no Suarez. So, you know, keep
an
eye
on this guy. Into the team, what you're saying is we'll see him in Arsenal colours for a year next season. Is that how it's going to work?
That could possibly happen. We'll see.
Yeah, it's very exciting over there. Some interesting transfers wrapping up in the European transfer window. Romelu Lukaku, who United, Solskjaer said they're short of a striker now, but he's over at Inter and scored a goal.
Yeah, and Man United have been clearing out quite a few players, actually, to Europe over the last couple of weeks. And there was talk that perhaps Solskjaer didn't have the respect of the senior players at Man United. And you're seeing a lot of those younger players coming through under his kind of guidance now and doing quite well. Mm. And there does seem to be a bit of an exodus of those sort of senior players from Man United too. So you do wonder whether there's a bit of truth to that rumour as well.
They've done a decent clear out there. Sanchez has also joined Lukaku over at Inter. Lukaku, who was horrendously racially abused in that game, but Sanchez has joined him, and that's quite good to get off their books, even if they are still paying most of his wages.
Getting just a bit of his wages of what, I think it's 300 a week. Something absolutely astronomical. That will help them. It'll help them run the club. It'll help them, maybe, like Jack said, get a bit of turnover going, make them a bit more of an attractive opposition. Yeah.
Also joining them in Italy, Chris Smalling.
Yes.
Roma.
I know.
That's an interesting one. And the Irishman, Mick Oterian. Who's also joined Roma, right?
Yes.
He's Armenian. I was just kidding. It's Henrik Mkhitaryan.
Henrik Mkhitaryan. Yes, Roma have made a huge amount of signings on deadline day. They've got a tidy little squad growing there.
Yeah. OK, very nice. Going ahead into the international break, feels like we've just started the season and now we're taking a break already. Do you sort of feel like it's time to take stock and it's like, right, the season starts after this one, now that we've sort of got the initial
pieces out there? I hate the international break. It's
rubbish. Yeah. Far too soon, isn't it, in the season?
Yeah.
We're just getting going.
Yeah, four or five games in and then, let's stop for 2 weeks and go and play some meaningless...
Well, it just ruins your fantasy football momentum as well. It's the worst.
That's the worst part of it, yeah.
Although for clubs like Tottenham, I feel like it's quite good because it actually gives them a chance to take stock and start again after the break. So from that point of view, it feels like they can get some momentum going.
Yeah, for teams beyond, say, Man City, who have a bit of some shallow depth, their squad, even Liverpool a little bit, it might actually help them just recover. It might help when you've got players like Alisson out injured as well. Just buy some bit of time. But I think for the fans, it's just a bit of it's such a damp squib to them go and watch England play bloody Slovenia or whoever.
Tell you what, though, it will be good when we have an international break in November, because that's when we'll be watching the All Whites, obviously. Mm. Cannot wait for
what?
That.
What?
Well, Republic of Ireland, first up, finally going to get a game, which is very nice. OK, that is us for today. Remember, you can find us at One News Now, Facebook, YouTube, and as a podcast in all the usual places. See you next week.